Hi everyone, thank you for coming and joining us. This is Los Quince Legacy Community Adelante, presented by the Department of Chicano Latino Studies and the Social Sciences Academic Resource Center known as SARC. My name is Santiago Flores and I'm a SARC peer consultant. Today I'm joined by SARC Director Carissa Sorensen and we'll be moderating today's lessons. If you have any questions, please submit them in the Zoom Q&A feature at the bottom of the screen and we'll address them at the end of the presentation.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Santiago. Before we introduce our panelists, we actually would like to welcome our Associate Professor and Director of Undergraduate Studies, Professor Glenda Flores. She'll be sharing a few words about the purpose and the goals of our celebration today.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for joining this webinar. I'm really glad that we were able to get three of, very important people that helped develop and establish Chicano Latino Studies at UC Irvine. The purpose of this event is that it's our 15 years, right, of being on campus. And I wanted to have a song at the beginning, like a vals, right, kind of like saying, oh, you know, it's reminiscent of like a quinceañero. technical issues and things like that, but just have them in your mind, right? But thank you so much for being here. I'm really looking forward to the questions that you ask our panelists. And if you have any questions about the Department of Chicano Latino Studies, our emphasis, becoming a major or minor, feel free to reach out to me at gmflores@uci.edu. Thank you.
And actually I do have the song that we can play right now. So hopefully you all can hear it before we really start. So hopefully it's playing right now.
Harp.
Okay, well, hopefully we can play the rest of it afterwards, but I think that would be a good introduction for our panelists today. But thank you, Professor Flores. And again, it's my great pleasure to introduce our distinguished panelists and pioneers, really, to this event today. Professor Emeritus Raul Fernandez, Distinguished Professor Leo Chavez, and Distinguished Professor Emerita Vicky Ruiz. We would like each of our panelists to talk about their experience forming the Chicano Latino Studies Department. And so you've all been given some guiding prompts and topics, but for our audience to kind of hear what we'll be talking about today is ultimately why a department like Chicano Latino Studies was needed. What was in the name, the curriculum design, and why you believe ethnic studies is needed now more than ever. So let's have Professor Fernandez, if you maybe would like to start. And then we'll just kind of go down the list.
Okay, well, thank you, Carissa, and thank you, Glenda, very much. I think what I'll try to do is to more or less chronologically talk about how we came about and how we exist, or why we exist. Let me backtrack a little bit. In 1969, UC Irvine created an ethnic studies program, which was called the Program in Comparative Culture. And one of the founders of that program was Professor Gil Gonzalez, who's now retired. And he is one of the four people that I think are essential to the history of our program. And I'd like to tell the story by referencing them. Gil Gonzalez is a historian, but he himself has a great history because he was the founder of the first Chicano Latino Studies program at Cal State LA when he was a graduate student. He was a participant in the famous anti-war Chicano moratorium in 1968. And he wrote the first draft of the educational program of the Plan de Santa Barbara, So he was with us from the beginning, but and in the 70s and 80s, as activism waned, certain elements at our university began to sort of push to disband that program in comparative culture. And they succeeded in doing that in 1990. They didn't count on the fact that a group of us, led again by Gil Gonzalez, decided we had to get together and try to see who could develop something else, could develop the Department of Chicano Latino Studies. So Gil is one of those people. If you want to find out more about him, you can go to our website, the Chicano Latino website, and click on graduate and then click on awards. We have an award for graduate student papers called the Gil Gonzalez Award. And if you click there, you will get a long narrative about his work, including his books on the history of education, as well as a link to a documentary that he made on the Bracero program. So he led that effort for a few years in a very systematic way, step by step. And then finally, after a few years, somebody else came into the picture, a person that was really committed to the development of the program. And he is with us today. His name is Leo Chavez, Professor Chavez. He is not retired yet, and I'm happy he's not retired yet. And so Leo began in a very methodical way, step by step, to see if he could try to move the program from a program to an official department. Okay. By the way, graduate students that are listening, I really recommend that that you connect with Professor Chavez. He's supposed to be an expert on transnational migration. He's an expert on a whole lot of things, okay? He's an expert on everything I can think of. And he's been a very, very good mentor to Latino students and to all students. Just to recount a couple, very recently, one of his PhD students, Diana Sanchez, a Zapotec immigrant, got a job in Chicano Latino Studies in the faculty in Santa Barbara. Also recently, one of his postdocs mentees, a young African-American scholar named Hannah Garth, became a professor of anthropology at UCSD. So if I were a graduate student, I would try and connect with Professor Chavez. Anyway, so as I said, he methodically began to move to really build a department. And then something happened that I think was really, really important in our history. So a third person showed up on the scene. She's with us today too. Her name is Professor Vicky Reese. And at that time, she was already nationally known. She's a person that had basically revolutionized the writing of Chicano history and the writing of US women's history. She had published dozens of articles and books, and has mentored, I think, dozens also of other people that are now teaching all over the United States and universities. Anyway. So the Department of History at UC Irvine wanted to recruit Professor Ruiz. And I think to their surprise and to the university's surprise, she said she would take the job, but she wanted to be a joint appointment with Chicano Latino Studies, which I think shocked a lot of people. Now, until that time, we were really, really we were walking on a tightrope. But then when Vicky Ruiz was appointed, I think that really for the first time gave us the assurance that we were here to survive. So finally in 2005, we became a full-fledged official department with a major, okay? And it took us 15 years to get there, okay? So Gil Gonzalez, Leo Chavez, Vicky Ruiz, I think are central to the history of our development. And there's a fourth person, okay? Because one of our first graduates, one of the first people that majored in Chicano Latino Studies, was a person by the name of Glenda Flores, who's still with us here today. And she was one of the first graduates. And here's the thing about Professor Flores. She studied with Gil Gonzalez, took courses with Leo Chavez, and took courses with Vicky Ruiz. And so after graduating with her bachelor's degree, she went to USC, became a sociologist, returned to UCI, has been here for about 7 or 8 years and is now an associate professor with tenure. She's teaching the 200A seminar. So I think we have to count her too among the four that I would say essential people in the history. And also if I was a graduate student or an undergraduate student, I will also Google her and try and look her up, okay? Now, of course, There are many others, okay? But as you get to know the department, you'll find out who those other really, really important names are. It took us 15 years to become a department, and then today we celebrate 15 years since we became a department. So I am very happy to be here today. I'm very happy that today we celebrate. And I want to give un millón de gracias to Glenda and to the SARC team for organizing this event. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Well, how about we have Professor Ruiz? Would you like
to
begin?
I was going to defer to Professor Chavez, sort of going order in which we came to UCI.
Sounds good.
Well, thanks, Raul, for all the nice words. And I echo all those nice words of everyone who is here. Alejandro Morales was actually here too, another important person from literature, which shows you our interdisciplinary strengths. You know, one of the key things, questions you asked is why was Chicano Latino studies needed here at UC Irvine? When I came in 1987, you could walk around campus and literally it looked like a Trump campaign. You didn't see many people of color here. You didn't see hardly any Latinos or Latinx or anybody. It was very difficult to find diversity here at UCI. And so why did we need Chicano Latino studies? Well, you know, we became the engine really to create the kind of diversity that this campus and this state really needs. It was a real need to hire faculty. And one of the key engines for hiring faculty is to have a department. So I think personally it became essential to really create this department to argue for increased hiring of Latinx faculty. The question about the name, you know, why Chicano Latino Studies? Well, you had, you know, other programs like at UCLA that are mainly Chicano Studies, but you know, beginning in the 80s, and my own work reflects this, you know, we became a much more diverse community. I mean, you had people from Guatemala coming, you had people from Honduras, El Salvador, Nicaragua, you already had Cubans here, you had Puerto Ricans here. And I think what we wanted was to have a program that reflected the Latino diversity that was becoming ever more evident in as you looked around campus and our society. And you could just look at the people who came here. I mean, we had Puerto Ricans who were here, we had Cubans who were here, Lisa Garcia Bedoya, we had Cynthia Feliciana. I mean, and so I think our department was a catalyst for diversity on campus and diversity in hiring Latinos from different backgrounds. And I think that's what made us, I think, a unique program in the country and one that I think is deserves the kind of recognition that it may not necessarily receive. Why ethnic studies now more than ever? I think a lot of legislatures are recognizing that rather than attacking and getting rid of Chicano Latino studies and ethnic studies program like in Arizona and some other places, it should become mandatory. It's basically the kind of need we're seeing right now with the Black Lives Matter movement, the kind of issues related to Latinos in the States and inequality, the growing inequality in America. It's just devastating. Which programs really study that in dealing with the kind of community we represent? And I think that's our program. I mean, not only should we and our students understand that, I think every student at UC Irvine should have to take a course in Chicano Latino studies in order to understand our history, our contemporary contribution to society, and everything else that we teach here at UCI. It's just, I think the program is wonderful. And I think basically it makes me really extremely happy to be on a quinceañera here for this program after all the blood, sweat, and tears we went through to get the program. I mean, I remember when I first came and I was made director, and as Raul said, I attacked it vigorously step by step because it was a laborious process of going through all the various committees on campus to get this done. But one of the first things I wanted to accomplish was to hire Vicky Ruiz. And so I would call her up almost every year, beg her to come to UCI. And she would tell me how she can't do it this year because she's got to take care of this, she's got to do care of that. And then one year, by a miracle, I happened to call. It was almost like it was on my speed dial. We didn't have speed dials at the time. But, you know, I called her just like, I go, Vicky, what do you think about this? I'm coming. I want to come. And I go, what? I couldn't believe it. And I think, you know, with the presence of somebody of the stature of Vicky Ruiz coming to the program, it just took us to a whole nother level. And it just made us have that kind of national and international recognition that just lifted the program. And I think, you know, we managed to hire just some incredible people because of that growing recognition of who we had here already. People wanted to join us and come here to be part of our program. And I can't really underemphasize the importance of the kind of hires that we've had, beginning with Vicky DeWeese. And I think the kind of recognition we had led to the medical school coming to our program, which wasn't even a department yet, and asking us to help develop the Prime LC program, which is Primary Medical Education for the Latino community. And they came to us and said, you know, we want you guys to develop courses to help teach medical students about the Latino community so they can be better doctors. At that time, we had 3.5 faculty or something like that. But I looked at Vicky, looked at Raul, looked at everyone and said, well, should we do it? And we said, let's do it. I mean, build it and they will come. And of course, based on that, you know, we hired just a lot more people after that, many of whom could teach in that program and continue to do that. So in a sense, we were always sort of ahead of our skates. We were always sort of ahead of where we wanted to be, falling forward all the time, but we never hit the ground, kept moving forward and created things, a program and brought in faculty that made us, I think, a really great program. But, you know, it's like you just have to kind of, the problem was when I came, we had people who, and they aren't with us anymore, and the names haven't been mentioned, who weren't taking the initiative and moving us forward. They were afraid to move forward. They were too cautious. And, you know, one thing about being, you know, our background is we don't want caution. We just want to run full steam ahead till we run into something. And that's what we did. And we created something. And, you know, I can't be more proud. And it almost brings tears to my eyes to think that we're still here and we still have such great faculty coming in and wanting to be part of the program. So thank you very much, Glenda, and everyone who's part of this and keep it going. Thank you very much.
I guess I'll follow up. First of all, you know, you can't see me very well on the Zoom, but I'm probably a bright shade of crimson. But I would like to say that it's been sort of the honor, certainly, in my career to be a part of this department. I knew it was a special place when I came in 1998, when the late Jeff Garcilaso brought me to campus. And I thought, wow, you know, we're working so hard develop sort of just a baseline of respect, because what we haven't really talked about is some of the real pushback that we received, you know, prior and after becoming a department for, you know, for what we do as researchers and educators and mentors. When I came in 2001, there was 12% Chicano Latino student population. When I retired in 2017, we were in HSI. I would have never imagined that Irvine would have been in HSI in 2001. When I came in 2001, and the Prime LC was just in formation, I was appointed to the committee. And it wasn't Chicano Latino Studies. We were in the running. We were one of two departments competing to be the partner program with the medical school. And the competing department is no longer in existence. In the School of Social Ecology, Environmental Health, I think it was called Environmental Health Sciences or something of that sort. And there was an older professor who was kept arguing against Chicano Studies. And I kept pushing him, and he goes, no, we don't need this culture. What we need is to teach these immigrants how to eat correctly, that they're not to use lead pottery. I mean, it was the most unbelievable nativist, you know, sort of soliloquy, and I turned and I just had it. And he said, wow, you have a lot of opinions for someone who just got tenure. And I said, I'm sorry, I'm full professor step five. I'm professor five. And Dr. Mineta's trying to ease the tension by going, oh, it's Vicky, it's just because you look so young. And I'm like, yeah, right. But, you know, Jose Rea, I think, you know, was really important, was an important ally. He was the director of Prime LC, and we were able to secure Chicano Latino Studies. And I was, you know, happy about that. And through that, we were able to get Professor Michael Montoya. And also, I think, isn't Belinda Campos the first full-time FTE in our department that didn't have to be a half, that didn't have to be a joint beside Raul and Gil?
Yeah, I believe so, yes.
That we actually recruited. to say, please come join us. And, you know, we just started pushing. We had a program review, I think, what it was in my early years there, where we waited 15 minutes for the committee to come in. I don't know if you remember this, come in. And they said, oh, we only have 15 minutes to talk because we were late from lunch. And, you know, you should be in humanities with the other ethnic studies programs. And then one of us asked, why? Well, because none of you are social scientists. And I think Gil blew a gasket in the only nice, understated, calm way that only Gil can deliver. And it was obvious they had not even read the CVs or had read the material. Fortunately, the next review, we had Adela Domodore on the committee, and Adela is now president of San Diego State. She's, you know, committed to geological studies. And she, you know, basically in her review talked about our conditions. Remember when it was even hard to get our offices painted? That we had World War II metal desks? And she wrote in the report that we were in third world conditions. And then around the same time, we were very blessed in that Judge Sarmiento was head of the Alumni Association. And he took a tour of our facilities. And he went to our then Chancellor Michael Drake and said, Chancellor Drake, what's going on here? I've seen all these, you know, really these really beautiful offices, and you know, and what are these conditions? And we got new furniture and paint, and it was such a big deal. Leo, how many times did you revise that document for the department? I mean, I think it was kicked back at every committee it had to go through.
I had to go to every committee that relates to, as it normally is, to in the creation of a department, and justify why we needed this department. And you had to start from scratch at every committee, and you mm-hmm. go in, send them the report, then you get it back, you revise it, go back again. And it's just, they never read it. They come up, as you said, same old, you know, arguments about, and a really sort of a detriment, you know, sort of a looking down on ethnic studies kind mm-hmm. of, is this really a discipline? Is it really something that should be at the university and that sort of thing? But, you know, eventually, yeah, as you talk and you talk and you talk and you talk and wear them down, they vote for it, and we got it. So the problem is, don't get discouraged at the absurdities that you hear, because you hear it every Absolutely. Day in the political campaign today too, right? Just keep hitting them back, as you say.
And just continuing to build, and we were a collective. What I loved about it is that we were a collective. We could disagree with one another in department meeting like no one's business, but after the vote was taken, we were together. And that really really helped us. And we were able to, you know, do some strategic recruitments, and, you know, and we're still growing, and we're still pushing for those FTE. And I don't think we have gotten the FTE that we've deserved, given how many students we serve, given, you know, our ranking. We were like, what was a former dean said, she was shocked at, you know, we were so highly rated in interdisciplinary programs. You know, given that we really need to be able, you know, to expand in terms of our offerings, in terms of our faculty. And I think it's remarkable in terms of what, you know, we've been able to do, and particularly this new generation coming up and taking leadership. I mean, who thought about, you know, going like Professor Flores went to STEM and to the STEM advisors about, you know, Chicano-Latino studies as a double major or a minor. I mean, we had to, I remember, you know, all of us had to contend with people who would, you know, advisors in other schools saying, oh, don't minor in Chicano studies, don't double major in Chicano-Latino studies. And, you know, I think we've come to a place where, I don't know, you can talk about this, Professor Flores, whether or not you think, you know, do you still get that sort of pushback?
Thank you so much, Vicky. I wasn't planning to be like one of the panelists, but do we get the pushback? I think the pushback is still there. but more often than not, I find a lot of students that when they do find us, they're relieved. They're like, I didn't know that we could learn this. I think most of our faculty in our department will say that. I just got an email from a student that's taking Latinos in labor saying that he had never heard of the Bracero program, even though he's of, you know, Mexican origins, and that, you know, that he's so happy that he's taking classes with us. So I think the students, you know, really value it. Carissa, do you want to go to questions?
Yes, we can certainly go to questions. So for those who are attendees, feel free to submit your questions in the Q&A, but Santiago will be actually reading aloud some of our pre-submitted questions that we received with the RSVPs. So go ahead, Santiago.
Thank you. So how can UCI help preserve the history of Chicano Latino studies? It's open to anyone.
Go ahead. I was going to say this, you know, obviously a number of things you can do. Be involved, become engaged with the program, with the department, take the classes, and I think really urge the school to provide FTEs, mainly because, you know, over the last few years, we've lost a lot of people in Chicano Latino studies, and we haven't replaced them. And the strength of the department, as you've already heard, is really based upon the strength of the faculty. And as you know, you winnow out the faculty and don't replace them, it can get pretty thin. And so I think one thing is, you know, take classes, become engaged, and encourage more faculty to be hired.
And I think on an institutional level, many of us, I know Professor Gonzalez has donated his papers to UCI. You know, I'm in the process of doing that as well. And it is it's important to keep that institutional memory as well, but it's also, you know, it's true in terms of, you know, enrollments, you know, having students, you know, getting credit for taking our courses, because often it's looked upon in terms of, you know, how many students you've got in lower division, how many in upper division. There's always this sort of this push, and it's a way in which to look at the fact that how well we've done and the personal mentorship that we've done for so many students, and how small we are, you know, relatively to other departments in the school and on campus.
Yes, I would add that those of us who know our department can help to spread the word. And what mm-hmm. I mean by that is this, every year, our faculty sweep the floors with the awards that they get for teaching, and they sweep it with the awards they get for research. We have a small faculty which is tops when it comes to research and it comes to teaching. Okay? Mm-hmm. So it'd be really good. The more people find out about that, I think the better off we would be. So that would be my recommendation. If you know about us, spread the word. And by the way, when I first started, and I think I started way back in 1969-70, one of the criticisms that Professor Ruiz and Chavez have referred to is like, well, this ethnic studies, this is kind of like probably not very good academically. It's probably this expression, Mickey Mouse. No one says that. Our courses are tough. Mm-hmm. People complain, the same people that like the courses, man, there's a lot of work in there. You know? So there is a lot of work, and there's great teaching and great research. So please spread the word.
Okay, we have some other pre-submitted questions I can ask, but I'd encourage everyone to ask questions in the audience. Here's another question. How do you balance the needs of students and create a sense of community and continuity? Oh, wait, no, I'm so sorry, I messed up. How do you balance the needs of students and the needs of faculty, especially in those moments when they may conflict? For example, the faculty may need more time, research time, and students need more mentoring and support.
Mm-hmm. Oh, might be a good question for current faculty, but I know historically, when I was a director and chair, it is one of the issues you want to keep in front of assistant professors is that balance, right? So that they manage to mentor students at the same time get their research done so they can get tenure. I mean, that's always a key balance. It doesn't mean you neglect one for the other, but you just keep in sight that, you know, you have those, that balance to maintain, because you want to get tenure too. But once you get tenure, I've always found that mentoring students has always given invigorated me.
Absolutely.
And given me more things to think about. In fact, you know, we don't only teach in Challenging Studies undergraduates, we mentor and work on and on committees for grad students. And I think that when you're working with students who are doing research projects at the undergraduate level or doing dissertations, I don't want to tell students this, but for faculty, it's a godsend. It's like you're giving us information and insights and pushing us along in ways that, you know, it's almost hard for us to do on our own because we're trying to keep up with you now, right? And so it goes both ways. We're mentoring at the same time. We're getting a sort of replenishment of ideas and knowledge too. So it's working both ways, you know? So just remember that.
Absolutely, I'll second that. You know, I was a better scholar because I was pushed by my students. And not only my graduate students, my undergraduates. My first job was at UT El Paso, and I had never lived on the border. And my undergraduates gave me an incredible education about life on the border and helped me, have a greater appreciation, and also, you know, prompted me, you know, to do research. But it was a whole different worldview. I was lecturing on the Farah strike. I had done work. I had done newspaper research. I had read about the strike, and I had worked really hard to put together this lecture. And these two women were in front row, and they were winking and giggling. And they were like nudging each other. And I'm going, and they were like always, you know, really sort of respectful students, both bilingual education majors. And they said, "Oh, we're sorry, Dr. Ruiz, but we were there." So it was like, I just turned it over to them. And they talked about what it was like, you know, the production quotas and what they were doing. And they said, Willie Farah did us a favor, because when we were laid off after the union came in, you know, we went back to school. And I thought that was it stands out like a teaching moment. But you're right, it makes you excited about what we do. It makes you excited about the discipline. And you get really excited, like graduation, and people are going off to professional school and graduate school, or, you know, and going in the classroom, you get excited about watching them and watching them develop, you know, through the years.
Yeah, I want to, I'm seeing questions and chats in there. I want to answer or try to answer one that I just saw.
Okay. As
to whether we are where we wanted to be. And I think one thing I like to say is that I think, you know, times have changed. And so we have tried to change with the times. And so that's why we became Chicano Latino Studies program, because the population was different. And then another example of that in the last few years, I think there's been an increased enrollment of Central American students who have rightly demanded that they be met, because they're not the same as those of other immigrants.
That's right.
And so we tried to move in that direction. And the last, we hired really prominent Central American writer, Hector Tovar. And thank you, Vicky, for that, because you fought like hell to get Hector Tovar here. And, you know, again, and then I think this year we actually have a professor of teaching who's also from Nicaragua, Alberto Morales. So our goals have to change because things change all the time. And I think we're trying to do a good job of that. Maybe not always perfect, but as good as we can.
So we have another question here. This person asks, or they said they're not majoring or minoring in Latinx studies, but they want to know if it's still possible to contact the faculty from this department and conduct research with you guys, or the department.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, I think we're a home for students and have always been a home for students. I mean, it gives us a lot of satisfaction, and it's also sort of expanding the net that, you know, they may not be majoring in Chicano Latino studies, but if they're, you know, taking our courses and then they come back and they come back to us and they spread the word about our courses. So absolutely.
And even more than that, I think it's great to work with students from all these different disciplines. And because, you know, sometimes they're too busy trying to take their own discipline to minor in Chicago studies. That doesn't mean they're not interested.
Yeah. So
I've worked with students and, you know, they weren't necessarily minoring or majoring, but they did great projects as undergraduates. And then they wind up going to med school or law school or into the business world. And they became successes and they drew upon that relationship they had doing that research with them in our program and in our department, right? So you never know. It's kind of like, you know, you toss the stuff out and you just like to let it blossom as it goes away. And it comes back later in some great way that you can never anticipate. So I think most faculty enjoy working with any student who looks promising,
absolutely,
is dedicated and has the energy and commitment to doing a nice project.
So this is one of our pre-submitted questions, and someone in the audience asked this. Will there be a Central American minor eventually?
Glenda?
Do you guys have any plans for that?
Yeah, Glenda.
Well, I think am I unmuted? Yeah. I mean, I think as the current undergraduate director, I'm finishing my term next year, I think, and then the incoming undergraduate director right now will be Professor Hector Tovar. So I'm pretty sure that this is something that will be, you know, on the table, especially when he takes over. And, you know, it's discussions that we've been having, but of course we need the institutional support in order to have the people to be able to teach the courses, right? And that have the expertise in that area. So I definitely see, you know, that it's a possibility for our department in the future.
Well, that's one of the areas I was suggesting, you know, the kind of push by students to hire or provide FTE to the department.
Yes.
This is one of the key areas, I think, where I'm surprised, you know, this hasn't happened, didn't happen this round, to tell the truth. And it should happen. So, you know, we can't let up.
Three rounds.
Put on the metal, because this has to happen, right? So,
yeah, I want to support that because, again, you know, this is what both Vicky Reese and Leo have spoken to, which is the needs and the reason that in order to meet the needs, we have to have the support. Because, for example, even before the expressed need for Central Americans came on the scene, there has been for quite a while an express need for emphasis on indigenous migrants
in
Latin America. Okay, the indigenous people, the Zapotecs, the Mixtec, I don't want to get into a tirade about that. But anyway, in order to really map that, we need faculty members that can do that. Okay? Mm-hmm. There's a lot of needs that we recognize that we're not really delivering on because we don't have the people to do it. We don't have enough resources to do it. So the more reason for it.
Yeah, I could even foresee, you know, hiring Afro-Latinos because, I mean, that is such an important topic. Another one that's evolved because after decades and actually centuries of not recognizing the diversity in Latin America with Afro-Latin Americans, Asian Latin Americans, indigenous Latin Americans, it's you know, we could have at least one or two FTEs in that to help develop that. And once again, these are the kind of forward-thinking ideas that our department is known for that really sets us apart, I think, from other ones that are much more narrow.
All right. I want to encourage people to keep on asking us questions in the chat, but let's see if we have more pre-submitted questions. Some people say that the field is becoming too professionalized, leaving behind its activist past. What do you guys think about that?
What was the question again? I'm sorry, I was looking at the Q&A up here, chats.
So the question is, some say that the field is becoming too professionalized, leaving behind its activist past. What do you guys think?
Well, I think in terms of, it's a coordinated effort. First of all, I think that our job is to support students, to support their activism. It is our job in terms of doing like what we can do in terms of community internships, experiential learning. Again, we need more faculty in order to do this kind of experiential learning. But I do think that we have to look upon the way in which for us, I think for Geological Studies ECI, is the fact that our survival and the fact that we have grown and our department was indeed a measure of activism, because it was fought for. And I think that with more faculty, I think that we certainly have had, you know, a number of Geological Studies. I know we're with the hunger strike years ago, and Leo and Raul, you can speak to that, the important role that the department played. So I think that in terms of the type of activism, you know, we have to look at sort of, you know, what are our resources, you know, our faculty, and the type of opportunities that we can bring. I think Prime LC is a type of activism in terms of what our partnership with the medical school, our work in terms of community internship programs. But when you have a small and very stretched faculty, I think our job also is that our job is to support student activism, to support our communities, to link our students with community organizations, if that is their interest and something they would like to do.
Yeah, I'd like to support what Vicky Reese has said. I think that it's not an either or proposition. Mm-hmm. I think that activism and professionalization go together. They go hand in hand. Let me tell you an example. And Gil Gonzalez and I started back in 1969, 1970 here. Gil Gonzalez was supposed to teach Chicano history, but there were no books. No one had written about it. The only thing about it was something that had been written by a journalist, a very, very good piece, a journalist called Kerry McWilliams, mm-hmm. who had written this piece back in the 30s and 40s called North from Mexico. I remember for the first 3 or 4 years that he was here and I was here, that's the only thing we could use. So Gilbert, whose credentials as an activist are impeccable.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Impeccable. He set out to write, and as Vicky well knows, one of the most prolific Chicano historians who has written, I think, 7 books, mm-hmm. documented the Bracero program. So both things are needed. Sometimes at some point, some things are more important than others. But one thing that people need to understand is that once you become a professor, once you join the faculty ranks, then you are subjected to particular metrics. Okay, and the metric that is most valued is your research, your productivity, your books, and your articles. You may think that is unfortunate. That is the way it is for all departments, all universities. And so if you come in as an activist and you remain pretty much of an activist, perhaps you will not last long at the university. So we have to combine both things, activism and professionalization.
Yeah, one thing I'm proud of our faculty is that not only are they distinguished scholars in their own right, but they're really active public scholars. And by that I mean they're giving talks all over the place, they're writing op-ed pieces, many of us testify in legal cases for immigrant rights. I mean, it's the kind of work that people are doing that, as mm-hmm. Raul says, often doesn't count.
Yeah.
In terms of a cap or, you know, committee on academic personnel, but it counts in terms of community. It counts in terms of the kind of rights people need, the kind of education the public has to have from people who know, like Chicano Latino Studies faculty. So I'm really proud that not only are our faculty scholars, but they're public scholars in many cases, willing to take that extra step, walk that extra mile, spend that extra time to really make the community and the society better, not just because we're teaching students, but we're out there engaging in kind of issues that really deserve to have the kind of insights that our faculty have. And so I'm really proud of that, to tell you the truth.
All right, so we got another question here from the audience. They're asking, what can students do to help advocate for more faculty and resources for the department? And what's the history of student involvement on campus?
Well, I mean, obviously we have a historian here, and Raul's lived it, and Vicky studies it. There's been no change on this campus or any campus without student activism. I mean, that's just a fundamental truth. And so in the old days, you know, when we were young, you know, marching, taking over the dean's office or the administration's office, going, arguing for more faculty, because it just didn't exist. I mean, it was crucial. Now we're in a different place. Now it's incremental. We need more on top of what we have. So maybe this issue is maybe the old methods may not work. Maybe there's some other strategies now that are more important. I don't know. But, you know, obviously we wouldn't be here if it hadn't been for student activism.
And there would not be a Dream Center here at UCI without student activism. Remember when we went to a meeting, it was just supposed to be the former Vice Chancellor of Student Affairs and some of his staff members and the students, and we crashed it.
Yeah.
You know, we didn't say a word. We were just there as observers, but we were so proud of our students. Yareli Castro Sevilla, double major in history and geological studies, an undocumented student activist, who is now, happy to say, passed her PhD quals at Harvard, and she's getting a PhD in American Studies. And her now husband, Julian Bugarin, who was one of ours, is now in his second year of law school at Boston University. So, but it's there, you know, that was our support. I mean, you know, they were kind of, I found out later, they were kind of thrown off by the fact that we showed up. Like, we were not going to show up to support our students. But, you know, we had been, you know, Anita had been like blue in the face talking with the vice chancellor about, you know, the necessity of the Dream Center. And, you know, not listen to us, but listen to the students. And the students have to realize that they have the power. I mean, they are, you know, the lifeblood of the UC.
Okay. Thank you for that. That was an incredible answer. How do you guys sustain the need for continuous change and the obligation to account for new student voices and demographics, even as the department develops ways to sustain itself and create a sense of community and continuity?
Well, I think we have addressed that a little bit. I think that, as I said, we try to adjust and change as change is needed. We've pointed out just briefly two of the things that we would like to fulfill that are needed: some kind of concentration on indigenous immigrants, some kind of faculty member on Afro-Latinidades, okay? The question is, someone has to give those resources. Mm-hmm. So we have to fight in the same, and we are, in the same systematic and methodical way that Leo Chavez and Vicky Reed did, to impose upon the administration the need that we have to have those kinds of resources. There is another thing that from a different perspective, I want to say that sometimes the reason why things are the way they are is because there are some difficult hurdles. So for example, many years ago, Vicky, this is before you came, when we first started, we were all men, okay? All men. And we tried for 2 or 3 years to hire women. And at that moment, first of all, there wasn't like large enough cohort in the United States. And there was a lot of competition. So we kept losing out to other campuses, losing out to Berkeley, or losing out to Stanford, missing, you know, getting people. Now we actually seem to have the opposite problem. We're mostly, you know, women in the department, okay? But sometimes the issue is that, for example, right now we have a person who has been teaching for us a course on feminisms of color, Maria Nubia Feliciano, who's a part-time lecturer with us. But I would like very much to be able to hire an expert on Afro-Latinidades for the department. The question is, I know there are several campuses doing that, across the United States, probably 20 to 30 to 40 trying to do that. And there is at this moment, there are very few experts on Afro-Latinidades. So not getting one depends on two things, whether we are given these resources to try and find one, and whether there is one out there that we can get. So it's not, you know, our wishes cannot usually be met immediately. You know, we have to be believing something that used to be called delayed gratification. We have to go steady at it, go methodically at it. Rome was not built in one day, and the revolution won't be televised.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Maybe I add just a little bit to that, because the question is about sort of where do we go from here kind of question, really.
Yeah.
And I would say that after this presentation, you might want to just check out more what's going on today with the department, because that's where you're going to see the faculty who came after us. And they're the ones actively engaged in developing the program, setting agendas. And so the question really is directed towards them. I mean, we're sort of, you know, we started the ball rolling down, yeah, the hill, and now they're the ones running with it. And so
exactly,
the question is really for them, right? What are they going to do? How are they going to do it? Because in a way, you know, it's yeah, not up to us anymore.
Yeah.
That's my opinion. It's up to them. And that's the way you want it to be. I mean, if you know, if I was helping set the agenda after 30 something years here, you know, it's an older agenda. No matter how much I try and keep up, I want the newer faculty to be mm-hmm, engaged and develop and move forward. So, you know, join in the discussion that's going on today in the program, in the center, in the department, and ask them, because I think you'll find some great answers. Mm-hmm.
All right, that's all our questions. If anyone wants to give any last minute questions, just go ahead and put them in the Q&A, but I wanna say thank you guys so much. That was, it was an incredible job.
Thank you. Yeah, if any questions emerge in the Q&A, I'm just gonna feel free to write them. I just wanna say thank you so much to our three panelists. And I wanna echo or kind of build on what Leo was saying about, you know, the agenda changing and maybe, you know, where do we go from here? But I do just wanna emphasize that I hope we can keep some of the things that were established by the founders of the department, which was the spirit of, you know, improving the experiences of students on campus. I will say that as an undergrad, right, one of the early grads, that it was Chicano Latino studies or Chicanx Latinx studies is where I learned about not only my own background, but also the different, the diversity within the Latino experience. And I learned a lot about Central Americans, Dominicans, Puerto Ricans, and lots of different Latino Latinx subgroups. So I think even with limited resources, I got a wealth of knowledge from the faculty and the department. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks, Glenda and the SARC team. Thank you so much.
Yes, thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
And it's nice to see you, Leo and Vicky. I don't see you.
I know.
We got to do this more often.
Absolutely.
Invite us back more often.
All right. Okay, guys. Yes. Take care.
Thank you. Thank you all so much.
Well, bye. There are no more questions that I'm seeing, but just, thank you, Carissa.
Thank you all, and we'll have this recorded later of our attendees afterwards.
Thank you, Carissa, so much.
Thank you. I'll go ahead and continue with the song so we could all enjoy. Thank you. Bye-bye.